Okay, so thank you very much for the introduction. So let's recall where we were last day. So we had D, G mod K. This is an Hermitian symmetric domain. For instance, as we have seen this morning, we can think that G is S to N, and then we divide by maximal compact subgroup. And for the moment, we have constructed vector bundles on G. So if we start with rho, a representation of K. Then we can define a C infinity vector bundle, B, just as G cross B over K. Or what we can do is to extend rho to a representation, let's say rho prime, from KC times P minus. Remember that we extend to KC just by extending the representation to the complex group, and we extend to P minus, declaring that it is trivial on P minus, GLB, and then construct B holomorphic as G C cross B now by KC times P minus. This is a vector bundle over my Hermitian symmetric domain. This is a vector bundle over the compact dual, the check that we know that has a complex structure. This one is infinity, this one is holomorphic, but BH restricted to D can be identified with B. Hence, we get an holomorphic structure on the line bundle we started with. So this is about vector bundles. Now, as we have seen in Arakelov theory, we also will need metrics on these vector bundles, because so we will need models, and then the metrics, in some sense, will be related to some kind of model or the fiber at infinity. So we need metrics. So how can we put a metric on a vector bundle like this? Well, the idea is that if I start with a representation of K inside GLB, I can look at a metric on B that is invariant under the action of K. So I can assume on B invariant under K. In other words, what I can assume is that B is a Hermitian vector space. And that rho is a unitary representation. So rho goes from K to U. This is a fancy way to say that the representation is, that the metric is invariant under the action of K. Now that the metric is invariant under the action of K, I can define a metric on the whole vector bundle B. So we can now, this induces a metric on this vector bundle B. So how I can get this metric? So the idea is that I have to look at two elements, U and B, inside the tangent space at a point P of B. Now I can look at a vector G such that G of P is equal to the point zero, and then I can define the Hermitian product of U and B in the point P as the product of G times U, G times B, inside G times P. But now I can identify in this construction, one can identify the orbit over the point O with B itself. Hence, I can write this as the product of G, U, G, B with the original element. So this is the tangent, this belongs to the tangent at zero of d. And this can be identified just with the original vector. So these are elements on BP, then these are elements on on B0, and this is the one that I can identify with B. Okay. And then this is the product on B. Now this shows you that if I want to get an invariant metric on B such that the restriction to B0 is equal to the original metric. So this shows me that any invariant metric such that the restriction to the fiber at 0 is the original metric has to be unique, and the fact that it is well defined. So what happens, when can I get other G such that GP is equal to 0? So if G prime satisfies that G prime of P is equal to 0, this means that G is equal to G prime times an element K of K, because it has to stabilize O, and then the product of G prime U, G prime B will be the same, or G U GB will be the same as the product of K G prime U K G prime B, and this is the same as G prime U G prime B, because the product was invariant under action of K. So we see that asking that the metric is invariant under K is what allows me to define a metric on the whole vector bundle. Okay. Now let's see an example. So we can follow this process here, and then I can look at the upper half plane. This is our favorite simplest example, and I can look at the line bundle LK that corresponds to the weight K representation. Now we are in a line bundle, so there is only one way up to constant to define a metric. And it turns out that the invariant metric satisfies that the norm of the vector B on a point tau is equal to the, let's say, the norm to the square, is equal to the absolute value to the square times the imaginary part of tau to the k. And as I was saying, a norm on a one-dimensional vector space is well defined up to multiplying by an scalar, so I have the freedom to normalize. Let's choose a normalization, yes, 4 pi, the imaginary part of tau. And this is the invariant metric on the case of linear forms. And this is exactly the metric that we have seen in the talk by Qingji last day in the modular form. So this is the invariant metric. OK. Now we want to make the quotient by an arithmetic subgroup. Now we have gamma inside G, an arithmetic subgroup. Now my vector bundle B is J equivariant. And the norm is G invariant. Hence, I can define a vector bundle with a metric on B mod gamma. Exactly the fact that the vector boundary is G equivariant implies that I can divide by gamma, and the fact that the metric is invariant means that I get an induced norm over gamma. In terms of total spaces, what we have is just B mod gamma over D mod gamma. So the fact that it is G equivariant means that I have the action of G, in particular I have the action of gamma, and I can take the quotient by gamma. Okay, let's see an example. Oh, before that, recall that this space, D gamma, let's call it X gamma. Recall that X gamma is a quasi-projective variety, and it lives inside this X gamma star, which is the Bailey-Borel compactification. Now, the problem with this compactification is that in general it's highly singular, because you are always adding components of much lower dimension, and there is a theory of toroidal compactifications . So the point is that here I have a singular variety. I can now appeal to the general theorem by Ironaka on resolution of singularities, and I know that I can resolve singularities. The problem is that if I do that, I will lose control on what I am doing. The good thing about the theory of toroidal compactification is that it tells me that I can look at certain cone on certain space that is related with the group G and the group K. I can look at cone decomposition on this space, and this codifies nice compactification. So I have compactification that depends on the group structure, and I can control them and look at them. So there is a theory of toroidal compactification, and in particular, if gamma is nef, is neat, so if gamma is smooth, we can choose a smooth toroidal compactifications with boundary a simple normal crossing divisor. So we can really construct very nice compactification. Well, normally this is a trade-off in the sense that normally the smallest your object, the better suited for computations, while theoretically it's very nice to have this smooth object. So normally what happens is when you are doing theory and you want to prove a big theorem without making your hands dirty, you go to these very nice toroidal compactifications with everything is smooth and so on. But when you want to make computations, you just go to the stacky thing that is dirty because it's the smallest one and it's where you can make the computations as is. But since I am just doing the theoretical stuff, let's go to this smooth compactification. Okay, now I have my variety, X gamma. On X gamma, I have a vector bundle. And on this vector bundle, I have a metric. And now I have very nice toroidal compactifications. Then the natural question is whether I can extend or not the objects to this compactification, for instance, to compute intersection numbers or compute heights and so on. For this, let's see an example. So let's look, as I was saying, I will look at the smallest possible case. So I will look at H, and then gamma will be SL2Z. Of course, this is not a neat arithmetic subgroup, so the quotient will be singular, H mod gamma. So this has to be thought as a stack or an as orbitfall because it has elliptic set points, but I will ignore it for the moment, and it turns out that this object is just like A1. but remember that it will have two points that are singular. And now I can look at the cusp, so I can compactify. So this guy will be called y1. Now I can compactify y1. In this case, the Bailey-Borel compactification or toroidal compactification is exactly the same. So this is just x1, which is a1 union a single point at infinity, which is just p1. Okay? And now I can look at coordinates. Q equal to e to 2 pi I tau. So the idea is that when we go to imaginary part of tau go to infinity, then the coordinate around the cusp tends to 0. So this is the local coordinate. And in particular, we can see that the imaginary part is equal to, from this equation, is minus 1 over 4 pi log of q, q1. So this is the imaginary part of tau. Now, if I have f a modular form, remember that yesterday we were looking at what was the cocycle that defines this line bundle respect to the action of the group. Now, what is a modular form? A modular form will be a section on the quotient. A section on the quotient will be given by a function on the on D that is invariant under the action of gamma. In particular, we recover the typical description of a modular form, but just the transformation. Okay, now I can write f as a sum on these coordinates of n belonging to the integers of a n q to the n. So this will be for another modular form. And now we can ask about conditions on how to extend this section. Now, typically, we will say that f is holomorphic. If a n is equal to 0 for all n strictly smaller than 0. But observe that this is a choice of how to extend the line bundle of modular forms. So the point is that by the general method of taking the equation, we have defined a line bundle on A1. A line bundle on A1 can be extended in many ways to P1, because I have to say what is the order of a section at infinity. Then asking that f is holomorphic if and only if an is 0 for all n bigger than 0, this is a particular choice. So in particular, what I am choosing is that the order at the cusp infinity of the function f is just the minimum of the n's such that an is different from 0. But this is a particular choice of the order at the cusp, and this is a particular choice of this extension. Okay, let's for the moment take this extension of the line bundle and then look at what is the metric, the norm of a section. So now f will correspond to a section S, and I can look at the norm of the section S with respect to the invariant metric. We have a nice description of the invariant metric. Yeah. So the invariant metric is over there. So this section will be just the absolute value of f to the square, and then 4 times 4 pi, the imaginary part of tau, to the k. But now we know that the imaginary part of tau is minus 1 over 4 pi log of q q bar. So this is just f square times the minus, or maybe let's write log of 1 over q q bar over k. Okay. And now we see that the metric doesn't extend to something smooth on p1, because this is giving me a singularity on the metric. So in some sense, this part here can go to plus or minus infinity, depending on the order of f. But this logarithmic part, I will not be able to make it disappear. So this logarithmic part will be here whenever I define the extension. In particular, we have that the log of the norm of S squared will be equal to the log of the absolute value of F squared plus then k times log of 1 over q, q1. Now, what we can do is the following thing. So since I have a metric, I can use the metric to detect a good extension of the Lie mantle. In the sense that if I have a section that vanishes with order n at a point, and I can look at the norm of the section, then I will see that the norm vanishes also with order n, or the norm of 2 squared with order n squared. And here we see that the order of vanishing of S is exactly the same as the order of vanishing of F, and then a logarithmic term. And in some sense, a logarithmic term is smaller than any polynomial term. So I cannot absorb the logarithmic term with any degree. So the only choice, the only reasonable choice I have is to declare that the order of S is exactly the same as the order of F. Hence, this choice here of asking this reason here. So in some sense, this extension that seems the most natural extension for homomorphic forms, in some sense, is the extension that is dictated by the Pedersen metric here. But what we see is that there is no hope to extend the metric to something smooth. So the metric will be singular when we extend to the compactification. Now to look at what kind of singularity, so we need to introduce a particular kind of forms. So remember that when it's working with Lie mantles, for instance, typically one looks at the norm of the section and the logarithm of the norm of the section. So this, in particular, for instance, is a green form for the section. It has this nice part that will give the green form part, but here we have this kind of singularity on the cusp, log of 1 over q. And if I compute, let's say, I over 2 pi, I think for the Chern form, the Chern form C1 of the Lie mantle of modular form metric. This is close to Q for getting this part here, will be I over 2 pi del bar of minus of this k log of 1 over q bar. And if we compute this double derivative, we will get just ek over 2 pi, and then dq exterior dq bar divided by q bar times log of q bar to the square. Now, this is a very nice differential form, because if I don't have this log here, this is not local integrable. So if I try to integrate this, I will get that the integral is divergent. If I just have one log q bar here, this will still be divergent. But with the square, now this is locally integrable, and I can integrate this form. So this form can be integrable. And this is the kind of singularities that appear in this form. So I see that the function log of the norm of S has this kind of singularity, and the first gen class has this kind of singularities. Okay, now what we want is to introduce a class of differential forms that in some sense contain this kind of singularities, but that has nice properties. So I want it to be an algebra, so to be able to multiply, and I want it to compute a nice control cohomology. So I can have, for instance, the DDC lemma and things like that are used a lot on Arakelov theory. So now let's say the definition. So now it's in part 4, log forms. Okay, just a little bit a warning. In some old papers of me with some collaborators, we were defining pre-log forms that are forms that has only control about the first derivatives, and the real log forms were forms where you need to control all derivatives, because at that point we only knew how to prove the Poincaré lemma when you control all derivatives. But preparing this course, I realized that one can very easily prove the Poincaré lemma just controlling the first derivatives. So then this all distinction between pre-log-log forms and log-log forms, we can drop it and just call log-log forms the easiest one and forget about the others, which simplifies a lot of things. But I think this is the first place where this is said. Okay, so now let's X be a complex variety. I smooth. And take D a simple normal crossing divisor. Now, I will say that a coordinate a neighborhood is adapted to D. So U with coordinate set 1 up to set n is adapted to D. If it satisfies two conditions, the first condition is that D is given by set 1 times set k equal to 0. So this is the usual definition of a simple normal crossing divisor, that it is, looks like a intersection of coordinate hyperplanes. And the second condition is just a stupid one, that the absolute value of set I has to be smaller than 1 over e to the square, something like that. This is just because I will write log of set, and I don't want log of set to be 0, so log of set to be minus infinity. So I want to be on the safe side. So the adapted coordinates will always be small enough, so I don't get problems in the formulas I will write. OK, now we will define log growth forms and log-log growth forms. So the idea is that I want to cook a complex of differential forms that allow me to work with this kind of forms here. Okay, so then definition. A function f on x minus d has log growth if for all coordinates before, the absolute value of f, set 1 up to set n, is smaller than a constant c times the product for I equal to 1 up to k of log of the absolute value of set I squared, if you want, to some power n. Okay? So it's just, it's bounded by the log of the coordinates. It's not smooth, but bounded by the log of the coordinates. And we'll say that a function has log-log growth if f of set 1 up to set n is smaller than a constant c, and then the same but with two logarithms, the product from I equal to 1 up to n of log of minus log of set I to the square and everything to the power n. So it's bounded by two logarithms. Observe that here, the function that appear here is just bounded by log-log. But I want an algebra, because I want to make products. So then I need also to bound by powers of log-log. And then the sheaf of log-log growth forms the sheaf of log-log-log growth forms is generated locally by log-log growth functions and the differential d of set I over set I log of set I bar, d of set I bar over zi bar and then log of zi bar for I equal to 1 up to k and dzi bar for I equal to k plus 1 up to n. Okay? So this will be the sieve of log-log forms, will be generated by all log-log growth forms and this kind of differentials. Observe that this kind of differential is exactly the difference I need if I want to get the Poincaré metric on the modular curve. Okay. Now about the notation, let's say, and finally, so this is a log-log growth forms, and then a form is a log-log form. So omega is a log-log form if and only if omega, delta bar of omega, and delta bar of omega have log-log growth. Because, of course, if I have a form with log-log growth, the derivative can be terrible. So if I want to have a complex, and I want to have a Dolbo complex with delta and delta bar, I need also to ask these conditions. Okay? Then the notation I will denote by E of x and then double bracket the forms with log-log growth, because as in some paper of the Lin with only one bracket, he was defining the logarithmic singular functions. So then with two brackets, this is the log-log singular functions. And I will denote, so this is the sheaf of log-log forms. And then E x star will be the space of global sections. About the notation. Okay? Now, why I am introducing this sheaf? Okay, yeah. So I will need also to introduce, let's say, d x star. This is the sheaf of currents. That I think already appeared in the talks by Soule. He already worked with currents to define green currents and so on. And we will denote E of x star, the sheaf of forms. Of smooth forms. And as I am doing here, I will write with Roman letters dx star the global sections. And with E x star also the global sections. So script letters will be the sheaf, and Roman letters will be the global sections. Now we have the following theorem. The first part is that if omega belongs to, let's say, E star x d, then it is locally integrable. So the map, so we get a map from E x d to the currents, dx star, that some omega corresponds to the current integration along omega. Mm-hmm. And this map is a morphism of complexes. In the sense that d of the current oscillator omega the differential in the sense of currents is the same as the current associated with dios omega. So not only is this local integrable, but it has zero residue. Okay? So this was already used by Manford in a paper about Hirzebruch proportionality principle. He was not using log-log forms, but he was using a very close kind of forms. But then the second part is that now I can look at Ex star. This goes to, let's say, Ep comma star. This goes to Exp comma star of d. So of course, I have defined the complex of forms, but it is clear that this complex has a big gradient, depending on the number of holomorphic and anti-holomorphic differentials. And I have defined these operators delta and delta bar. So I can look at this guy with the operator delta bar inside this complex with the operator delta bar. And now I can send it to currents with the operator delta bar. Again, p comma star. And then the second part of the theorem is that these maps are quasi-isomorphisms. Okay. So in particular, this implies that this complex of log-log forms computes the cohomology of X with its Hodge structure. So it computes really the good Hodge structure on the cohomology of X. And in particular, I have a delta-delta bar lemma for this kind of forms. This will come later. Okay, how is it? Okay. Okay, let's give a proof of the second part of the theorem. So as I was saying, the first part was done by Manford, and let's prove the second part. So the main tool for proving this result, okay, so what we know is that if I want to prove that these are a quasi-isomorphism of sheaves, I know that going to stalks, to fibers, is an exact functor. Hence, looking at the exactness of this map of sheaves is enough to look it to do it locally. So it's enough. So I can look at Ex at some point X star going to Ex X star, so P comma star, P comma star. D going to D X X P comma star. So I can look at a map like this. Now I also know that this composition is classical. This is a quasi-isomorphism. So if I look at the map inducing cohomology, so I have this map, the cohomology of this guy, E P star XX going to the cohomology of P star X, cohomology of E XX P comma star of D going to the cohomology of this guy here. I know that this composition is an isomorphism. Since this composition is an isomorphism, I know that this map has to be injective and this map has to be surjective. So the only thing I need to prove is I want to prove that the map in cohomology is an isomorphism. The only thing I need to prove is that this map is surjective. So I need to prove that if I have a form with log-log growth that is close, I can modify it by a boundary to get a smooth form. So this is the only thing that it remains to be proved. Okay? Now, how one can do that? To do that, one uses the Bogner-Martinelli kernel. So I look at the following differential from Cn. On Cn, I look at the form Kn of Z is equal to minus 1 to some power that I don't specify, n minus 1 factorial divided by 2 pi I to the n. And then the sum minus 1 to the I minus 1 of Z I bar. And then d z1 exterior exterior d z I bar bar. And here this means that this one is omitted. Then exterior exterior d of z n bar. Now I put d of z1, d of z n. And then I divide everything by the norm of z to the 2n. So I get this. This is an n minus 1 n form. Then one can check the following facts, that delta of kn is equal to delta bar of kn is equal to 0. But if I look at the current, the associated current, and I look at delta bar of the associated current, it turns out that this is exactly the same as looking at d of k of n, and is just the Dirac delta at 0. So this is very close to be a green current for the point 0 on Cn. Instead of asking that ddc of this is delta 0 plus something smooth, I am just asking that delta bar of this is just the current integration along 0. And this is the important thing for this current. So in some sense, we can forget now about this, this shape. And the important thing is that this satisfies this equation. Now, I look at the map pi that goes from Cn cross Cn to Cn, that Zw goes to Z minus W. Hence, pi minus 1 of 0 is just the diagonal of this map. And then I can look at P upper star of Kn. Then I will write this as Kn of ZW. And this is the Wagner-Martinelli kernel in Cn cross Cn. OK, now this satisfies that delta bar of the current, Kn of ZW, is equal to the integration along the diagonal and delta of this Kn ZW is equal to 0. Okay? And now one can use this kernel to prove the Poincaré lemma, for instance, for currents, or the Poincaré lemma for differential forms. Because now I can do the following thing. So I can define the operator K. That goes from E X D P Q with compact support. So I have to take forms with log-log growth with compact support to, for the moment, let's say, to the currents on X P Q, P Q minus 1. And what I do is the following thing. I start with a form omega. And then I send this form to P2 star of omega. Then I multiply by Kn of ZW. And then I send it back by P1, where Cn cross Cn, I have P2 to Cn. This will be the second coordinate, so the W coordinate, and this is P1, is the first prediction. So in principle, I'm saying that I go to currents, because here I have a direct image, and in principle, a direct image will only go to currents. Then the lemma is that k of omega belongs to Ex, so Exp q minus 1 of b. So the important lemma is to show that if I start with a form that has log-log growth along let's say, growth. So GR means that it has log growth along this form. Okay? So and satisfies the following properties: delta bar of k of omega plus k of delta bar of omega is just omega, and it satisfies that delta of k of omega plus k of delta of omega is equal to zero. Mm-hmm. So the point is that if I start with a form omega that has log-log growth, let's say, then I can construct this current. So I pull back to Cn cross Cn, I multiply by this Wagner-Martinelli kernel, and then I integrate along the fiber to get now a form on the variable set. And then the lemma tells me that if I start with a form with log-log growth, then I get a form with log-log growth. And not only this, but it satisfies these nice properties that delta bar of k omega plus k delta bar of omega is omega. This is just a reflex of this property. And delta of k of omega plus k of delta of omega is equal to zero. This is just a reflex of this property here. Okay? And now from this lemma, I can conclude the theorem. So let's assume this theorem. Okay. So now I want to prove that the mapping cohomology, at least in local cohomology, is surjective. And also, it is easy to see that if I start with a form that is not only of log-log growth, but is log-log, then these conditions imply that when I apply k, delta bar of k is also log-log growth, delta of k is also log-log growth, and delta bar of k is also log-log growth, so I get a log-log form. So now I start with omega, which is Exx pq b closed. Okay, this is a local statement, but in any case, any element of this style can be represented by a closed form in some neighborhood of the point b. And now I can look at a function rho, a boom function. This means that rho is equal to 1 in a neighborhood U that contains 0, and rho is equal to 0 in B, the complement of B, where 0 is in U, is in B. Okay, so it's a function, it's a partition of unity. And then I can look at the function rho times omega, and this is a form with compact support. The problem is that now it's not longer closed. So I started with a form which was closed, but maybe it has no compact support. I multiply by this function, boom function, and now I have a form which is which has compact support, but is not closed. But I can look at the, I can apply k. So the main problem with this operator is that in order to apply this operator, I need to start with a form with compact support, because I want to integrate. If it has no compact support, I cannot integrate. Now I can look at delta bar of k of rho of omega. Now, using that delta bar, delta bar of rho times omega. Here I am using that omega is close, is delta bar close. So I have this thing here. This is equal to rho times omega. But now I can restrict everything to U, And then rho times omega restricted to u, this is just omega restricted to u, no problem. This is a delta bar of something. And now the key point is that, so the problem is that k is not a local operator. But what one can show is that taking delta bar of rho, since rho is flat around zero, one can show that this guy is smooth. Because it will not touch the singularities. Hence, what we have here? We have that my form, that was a log-log form that was delta close, can be written as delta bar of something, which is a log-log form, plus something which is smooth, locally. Hence, I get that my map is surjective, and hence, it is an isomorphism. Is clear? Okay. So this is very much like the proof in Griffiths-Harris that the complex of currents is quasi-isomorphic to the complex of differential forms. The only point is that the proof in Griffiths-Harris is wrong, because he assumes that this operator is local, which is not. And so at least this is the same proof, but now this works, and in Griffiths-Harris it doesn't work. Okay. So now we have this theorem. We have that the complex of log-log forms is a quasi-isomorphism. So we get the following corollary. So assume that X is projective. In fact, it is enough to assume that it is scalar, but let's assume that X is projective. And I get omega, an element in EPQ of XD, which is close. Then there exists a U inside EP minus 1, Q minus 1 of XD, such that omega plus ddc of u belongs to epq of x. So the point is that if I have a differential form with log-log differential form that is closed, I can modify it by an element in of a log-log form of degree p minus 1, q minus 1, in such a way that this is, that it is a closed form. Okay? So this just follows from the usual delta-delta bar lemma on differential forms and this fact that the log-log forms compute exactly the same cohomology as differential forms. Okay, now why we want to lose time studying these log-log forms? Now we have to appeal to another theorem by Manford. Well, before another definition, so I have again x as before, and now I have b, a vector bundle on x, and I have a norm, a metric, smooth metric on x, on b, restricted to x minus d. So I have my vector bundle is in the whole variety, but the smooth metric is only on the complement of d. Then we say that the metric is log singular if two things happen. The first thing is that hij, so the smooth metric will be given by, in a particular frame, by functions hij, a particular frame, and then I have to ask that the elements hij and the inverse of the determinant has to be of log-log. And the second condition is that the connection associated to the matrix that is given locally by delta of h times h minus 1, or delta bar of h times h minus 1, ig. Now, I have to ask that these forms are log-log forms. Okay, so a metric is log-singular if it satisfies two things. All the entries on the metric have log growth. The inverse of the determinant also has log growth. And the forms that appear in the connection associated to the metric have log-log, are log-log forms. So they have log-log growth, and their derivatives have also log-log growth. This implies that now if I compute the Chernin forms of this vector bundle, they will be log-log forms. Mm-hmm. So I will be able to use this to compute the Chernin classes of the vector bundle. And now finally, I can write down the theorem by Mumford. Now the problem is that I am using D for a divisor, and now I change notation, and D will be my Hermitian symmetric domain. So I have D an Hermitian symmetric domain. I have a gamma an arithmetic group. I have rho from K to GL of B, a unitary representation. And then let E0, comma, this thing, the Hermitian vector bundle, on x. Now x will be just g mod k mod gamma. Okay, so I have explained how from this representation, a unitary representation, we can get an Hermitian vector bundle on this quotient here. Okay, now let x bar be a toroidal compactification of x. Let's assume that gamma is a neat arithmetic group, so I want the quotient to be smooth, and I am taking a toroidal compactification of x with x bar minus x, a simple normal crossing divisor. Then, finally, there exists a unique extension E as of E0 as a vector bundle with a log singular metric. So the point is that if we insist that the metric has only log singularities, then this theorem tells us that it exists a unique extension. Okay? Now, remember that in this construction from this representation to this Hermitian vector bundle, so this was not arbitrary, this was fully decomposable. Vector bundle. So, and I have to confess that I don't know what happens if we take an interesting vector bundle that is not fully decomposable, like the whole Hodge bundle. So I don't know if this theorem is true. So Mumford only states for fully decomposable, and I don't know what happens in general. Okay? But the important thing is that if I have my Shimura variety, which is non-compact, I have an automorphic vector bundle. So vector bundles obtained in this way will be called automorphic vector bundles that come from this representation, then I can extend to the compactification in a unique way, in such a way that the metric is log singular. And if the metric is log singular, then automatically I know that the Chern classes of the metric will be log log forms. And I know that the log log forms compute the right cohomology. And it turns out that the Chern classes, as log log forms, compute the Chern classes. So the basic idea is that log log forms are not smooth. but they are almost like they are smooth. So we can use Chernobyl theory, and everything works like they are smooth forms. Okay, how much time do we have? Ah, I still have an hour. Ah, okay, good. It's difficult to see the small one. Okay, perfect. Now that we have log-log forms at our disposal, now we want to do a Arakelov theory on Shimura varieties. And the point is that what we see is that the matrix that we obtain in a natural way on Shimura varieties, the matrix that we will be able to work with, are not smooth. So we cannot apply directly the method of Gilles-Soulet. So then we go to the last part. Now we want to do Arakelov theory on with log-log forms. Now it depends on if one wants to do just the show that one can define things, or one wants to make computations. So now we have our Shimura variety. This Shimura variety will have a boundary divisor. And we know that the matrix that we will use will have singularities on this boundary divisor. And hence, the differential forms we will use will have singularities on this divisor there. Now we want to define intersection arithmetic intersection products using this kind of singularities. Then if we are willing to admit that our cycles will be far from the boundary, then we will just use almost the same techniques as Gilles-Soulet. But the problem is that normally the objects that are easy to handle are the objects that live in the boundary, because the boundary is exactly what is special. So if one wants to be able to give the intersection number for objects that live in the boundary, then one has to be a little bit more careful. Since I don't have much time, I will explain just how to show that things can be defined with log-log forms using the moving lemma that allows me to move every cycle away from the boundary. Mm-hmm. Okay, so then the idea is that now we have log-log forms. Log-log forms compute the same cohomology as smooth forms. So let's do Gilles theory, just replacing smooth forms by log-log forms. Okay, so the idea is to use same definitions. As Gilles-Soulet, but using log-log forms. Okay. So now, what is the setting? So I have now X over spec C, an arithmetic variety. So I will assume, for instance, that it is regular. So this will be, let's say, projective, proper, flat, and regular. Projective, proper, flat, and regular. And over an integral over spec. In some sense, I need all of these conditions to be able to define the arithmetic show groups. But in particular cases, for instance, if I only want to multiply by line bundles, then, for instance, I don't need regular at all, because multiplying by line bundles can be done without many hypotheses. I will use moving lemma, but again, multiplying by line bundles, I will not need projective. So in fact, with proper and flat, many things can be said, but since I want to give the full ring, then I will need to add all these hypotheses. And I will assume that I have D inside XC, a normal crossing divisor, simple normal crossing divisor, that is fixed under the involution F infinity that appeared in the talk by Gerard. So in fact, this means that this divisor has to be defined over R. In general, it will be already defined over the integers, but or over Q. But let's assume that I have a divisor defined over R. And now, what is a green current? So let set be a codimension P cycle on X. Now, a green current, a log-log green current for set is a P minus one current on XC, invariant again under F infinity, such that DDC of G, so a green current for set, let's say a PP current, G set, so DDC of G set plus the current integration along C complex that we will denote by omega C. Now this element, instead of being a smooth form, I will ask it to be a PP form on X, C, but with log-log singularities along D. So it's exactly the same definition as a green current in Jesule, with the only difference is that I am asking that DDC of GC plus delta C is an element in this element here. Now, if you have studied the arithmetic intersection theory of Jesule, one has a big problem with this definition, and this is that this current, this is a current. So we cannot multiply two currents in general. We cannot take the inverse image of currents. So there is a theorem that tells us that every such current can be represented by a green form with logarithmic singularities on set. So what we know is that there always exists, let's say, G prime, a green form on X with logarithmic singularities along set. That represents a prime set. Okay? That represents this. So the basic trick on Arago theory is that okay, we start with a green current, but we can always find a form, a differential form, with only logarithmic singularities along set to represent this current. And we can use now this form to make intersection products and to define inverse images. Now we can use, let's see, no, it's not here. So remember that I have proven that the cohomology of log-log forms is the same as the cohomology of smooth forms. And I say that as a corollary, we have that every close log-log form can be altered to a smooth form just by adding DDC of something. Now, this omega is automatically close because this current is close, this one is close, hence this guy is close. Hence, we have the following proposition. So let's say that G is a log-log log-log green current for set, then there exists a U inside E P minus one of X D, so a global form with log-log, which is log-log along D, and G prime set a smooth, a classical green form for with logarithmic singularities. With log singularities along set, such that U plus G prime set represent G set. So instead of having a green form with log singularities along set, we need to add some log-log singularities along D. But it's the same result as before. Remember, what does it mean represent? Remember that a green current for set is a pi minus one current up to the image of delta plus the image of delta pi. So green currents are defined up to boundaries. Okay? And now this proposition allows us to transfer all the, or most of the structure of arithmetic groups, arithmetic subgroups. For instance, let's do the intersection theory. So assume that I have set G set. Oh, sorry. Let's make first the definitions. So we'll define set P of X, and then with log log singularities along D. This will be the space of all pairs, set G set, where set is a codimension P cycle, and G set is a log log green form. Now we can define the rationally equivalent to zero cycles. And this will be just the same as in Tietzschule case. So it's the set of objects of the form, the divisor of F, and then the current associated to log minus 1/2 of log of F, F bar. And then Chou had P of X D will be just set hat P of XD divided by rat hat P of X. Okay, so this will be the arithmetic subgroup. So the only thing is that we allow our green currents to have log-log singularities along the boundary D. Now, in order to define the star product in this setting, so we take set G set and W G W, arithmetic cycles, but such that the complex points, so the complex cycle of Z and W intersect properly. But the problem is that they have to intersect properly among them. And with this divisor D. So I cannot make the star product for any cycle that intersect properly, but I have to assume that they also intersect properly with D by using this result. So using more elaborated homological techniques, we can define a star product even if the product is not, so the product with D is not proper. But in order to use just directly this technique, I need to assume this. Then I can define G set star GW just as the classical definition. So this will be just omega set exterior GW. So this is no problem because omega set is a log-log form, and GW is again a sum of a log-log form plus a smooth form with log-log singularities. Hence, we will get a current of the same style plus, and then GZ exterior delta W. And again, the transversality conditions imply that this current will also be integrable and will work perfectly. So then this GZ star dW is a green current, a log-log for set intersection W. And now, if I have a map F from Y to X such that FC minus 1 of D is equal to E, simple normal crossing divisor. In fact, I don't need to be equal. I think is I just need to be included in a simple normal crossing divisor. Then I can define, there is defined an F lower star that goes from CH hat of X D to CH hat of Y E. This star product now, I can use exactly the same technique as Dirac-Soulet, and this gives me a product, CH hat of X D, tensor, so let's say P, tensor CH hat Q of X D to CH hat P plus Q of X D, but tensor with Q, as before. So remember how it goes. So I can use the moving lemma. So I have two cycles. Now over C, I can use the moving lemma to make it intersect properly among them and intersect properly with D. And then I can make first the finite product in the Chow group with finite supports and the product on the generic fiber. And then I get the product here. Mm-hmm. Okay. And also, I have a map. So for the direct image, things are a little bit more complicated, but I will only need the direct image to the point because log-log forms are local integrable, so in particular I can integrate along the whole space. So there is a map, so I have this map pi from X to a spec set. It induces a map pi lower star from CH hat. Let's say X has dimension D plus 1, relative dimension D. So this will go from CH star of X, comma D. And this goes to CH hat star minus D of spec set, comma nothing. So I can give the direct images. In particular, I have all the ingredients I need to do the following thing. So if I have X a Shimura variety, a toroidal compactification of a Shimura variety, and I have L bar, an automorphic Hermitian vector bundle, an automorphic Hermitian line bundle for the moment, then I can define the height with respect to L bar of X using this theory. So I can. But in fact, one can do more because one can not only extend work with line bundles, but Manford theorem applies to fully decomposable vector bundles. So in fact, theorem. There is a theory of arithmetic characteristic classes. That goes from automorphic, fully decomposable Hermitian vector bundles to this CH hat of a Shimura variety with log-log singularities along the boundary. So we can extend not only to line bundles, but to any automorphic vector bundle as long as it is fully decomposable. So, and maybe I can write an example of a computation. Well, in fact, this was the first example, and it predates all this theory. And I think Juan has already give this example. So, example, this is due to Bost and Kuhn, and is the first case of an intersection number of this kind for the modular curve. So Bost used, Bost extended the theory of Gillet-Soulet to L2-1 forms. L2-1 forms are a kind of singular forms that also, in the case of curves, included these log-log forms. And Kuhn make also a theory of generalized intersection. And in some sense, this was the starting point of this project, because how to extend all these things from curves to higher dimensions was the starting point of this project. But what is this example? So we can now let X1 is the upper half plane divided by this SL2 C star, so the compactification of the modular curve, which is equal to P1. Here we can look at MK1, so the line bundle of modular forms of degree K. There is a way to extend this to an integral model. I will not enter into this, but we can compute then the C1 hat of this line bundle of modular forms and look at the self-intersection from K1. And the self-intersection is given by a logarithmic derivative of the Riemann zeta function at the point minus 1. So it's equal to k squared, where k is the weight, times 1/2 of the Riemann zeta function at minus 1 plus z prime at minus 1. Of course, if we normalize over the degree, we get the logarithmic derivative of the Riemann zeta function. OK, and then I hope that during the course we will see many other examples or some other examples of intersection theory of this type. OK, thank you very much for your attention.